There's a lot I miss about the humid tropics when I'm back home in the colder north. I mean, don't get me wrong, Canada's great too in its own ways. But one of the things I find so fascinating about rainforests is how the vegetation seems like a landscape all to itself. Thanks especially to the mass of tiny plants covering every free surface, a tiny forest within the larger forest. And to add to that likeness, like any living landscape, not only do you have tiny plains, hills and valleys, forest groves and nooks and crannies, but also water is a part of it too. But water usually can't sit very well in the treetops, in the hollow of a dead tree perhaps, maybe a broken branch, but really it's more the epiphytes that create this aspect of the landscape. And what better plant to show this with than one of the most iconic and subtle yet still crucial groups of plants from the American tropics? Bromeliads.
You've probably seen some of these before. They tend to be quite photogenic, and they include some very popular houseplants and even a popular food crop, the pineapple, though that one grows on the ground, not in trees. There are a number of bromeliads that do that, including this one. This one, I think these sometimes grow in trees, but this one was just planted on the ground. And there are bromeliads that look nothing like this, but today I'm kind of talking about the classic bromeliad form, those with tanks. They have their leaves coming out like this from a central rosette with leaves tightly connected at the base and not just, you know, regular tight, but like watertight. In wet environments, you'll often see a bit of water pooled up inside here. This one's kind of a medium-large one, but they do get a fair bit larger than this. Some of them even hold up to about 2 liters of water. And we call this water storage area either a tank or a phytotelma. Now, this may look only moderately interesting, but it has some pretty far-reaching consequences. How so? Well, the most obvious part, this can be a great way to store up water in a place where water can be quite hard to come by, up high in the canopies. Often these will have either roots within their tank, or sometimes little absorptive hairs with one-way valves to suck water into the leaves. And not only water, but also nutrients from falling and decaying plant and animal matter, tiny windblown particles all getting into the water there. So great for the plant, but also quite a boon to the forest community at large. Plants aren't the only thing that like water, and to animals way up high in the canopy, these can be vital. This may not look like much water, but it really adds up. One study was done where an area of rainforest was examined, and about 175,000 bromeliads were found per hectare. And in total, they held about 50,000 liters of water. And obviously, with lots of water pools around like that, birds, monkeys, other small animals, they'll use these as a drinking fountain. Saves them from having to go all the way down to the forest floor to find water. I mean, sometimes these things will protect their water reservoirs with little spines on their leaves and stuff, but that only goes so far. But besides that, this water tank, this phytotelma, opens up a whole new world of real estate to animals that live in water, to be not just limited to water bodies down on the ground, but now to even occupy space way up in the canopy. The neighborhood just got a lot more 3D. Salamanders, tadpoles, all kinds of insects and their larvae, sometimes even like crabs and strange little things like ostracods, and of course, a whole bunch of tiny microscopic things. And it's not even just the main tank here, like each leaf you can kind of see has its own little pool. No matter how tiny, as long as there's a long-lasting pool of water there, you will find life in it. A study was done in Ecuador where they chose 209 bromeliads and examined them and their contents. And in total, they found about 11,000 different animals, coming from over 300 different species. Not all living there, but using them in some way. Some maybe just drinking, some maybe hunting other animals that were living in there. And many of the species you find in these are actually unique to these bromeliads. Like there's this certain species of crab that in the larger bromeliads, it'll make these multi-generational homes and you can have a few dozen living in the same bromeliad. Like these kind of work like islands in reverse, little havens of water so that all kinds of water-loving life can colonize into the canopy. And to come full circle, that all helps the plant. Not all. Sometimes animals end up biting the hand that feeds them, like monkeys pulling out the leaves and eating the cores, but so much of this animal activity directly gives nutrients back to the plant through waste, death, and decomposition. So you can see how these play a pretty huge role in rainforest environments. But these aren't the only plants like this. Phytotelma, these water tanks, they show up in a bunch of other plants, and this is where you can even have those in areas like Asia, where you don't natively have bromeliads.
But this struggle to hang on to water isn't unique to the large plants here, or even plants with tanks. In another video, I mentioned some other adaptations for collecting water, including mosses like these, which act kind of like a sponge for the water permeating the humid atmosphere and running past. And this happens at the macro level and at the zoomed in level. And this is one of the reasons I love this analogy of the rainforest plants being like a landscape themselves, is that it works as a fun way to visualize even many of the small nooks and crannies of the rainforest. So to finish off by zooming in quite a bit, not literally because I don't have a good macro lens, but a group of organisms that very seldom gets talked about, epiphylls. Now, if you know some botanical Latin, which ironically in this case and many others is Greek, you may be able to guess what this word is referring to. We have epiphytes from the Greek words for upon plants that grow on other plants, on trunks, branches, etc. But trees have more available space for things to grow on. So if you're a tiny moss, liverwort, or lichen with a good clinging grip so you won't be lost to the wind and the pelting rain, you might do well as an epiphyll, from the Greek for upon leaves.
As you can imagine, things that live like this are generally pretty tiny, and tiny mosses, tiny algae, unfortunately they can be hard to identify and often aren't that well studied or well known about. But they do have big effects. You've probably seen microscope shots before showing just how much life there is when you zoom in on really any plain looking surface.
Almost looking like small alien forests. The same goes for leaf surfaces. They already house a lot of microscopic life, but imagine how much more life they can house if, when you zoom in, you add these epiphylls, a slightly larger, tiny alien forest, or perhaps shrubland, for the microscopic life to grow on. It's a subtle difference, but ultimately a pretty significant one. An extra layer of forest.
One that does many of the things the larger forest will do. Trap water, collect wind-blown particles, collect nutrients, photosynthesize.
Studies have even found that some epiphylls will fix atmospheric nitrogen into plant-usable forms, which is a vitally important nutrient for the larger plants. These have also been shown to help protect leaves from herbivores at times, due to some of the chemicals they produce, and there also may be an element of making the leaf look less fresh and attractive to browsing munchers. So in spite of taking some of this leaf's light, and perhaps leaving the leaf more open to infection by keeping it more wet, giving shelter to many fungi and microbes, there is some benefit to the host plant, even if it is a mixed blessing.
Add this together for every epiphyll in the area, and you actually have a fair bit of impact on the larger community, affecting the cycle of water and nutrients within the broader ecosystem. But anyway, yeah, that's all I have for this week. As always, thank you for liking, commenting, and subscribing. And for more weird and wonderful plants from around the world, join me next time on Ambling with Sam.